appeasement, Chamberlain, Hitler, Churchill, and the road to war. And he joins me now. Let's talk a little bit about first today, the remembrance on the 75th anniversary. What do you make of how the world is choosing to remember D-Day in 2019?
Well, I think the world's done a fantastic job at it. It's hugely important, and it's important because not just for what it did, but because there aren't going to be that many further occasions when all these veterans are going to be able to gather together. And I think it was incredibly moving to watch veterans mingle with world leaders, but also world leaders stand together. And if there is one great lesson from the Second World War is that nothing like this should ever happen again. And international cooperation is far better than international antagonism.
Well, we heard Donald Trump, the proponent of America First as his main centerpiece policy, talk about international multilateral cooperation in this particular speech.
Yes, D-Day was, and it's very important for everyone to remember this, that you don't get focused on your own nationalities. A multinational effort. Aside from Americans and British, there were Australians, Canadians, New Zealanders, and Free French who were doing a vital job behind enemy lines. And there is a slightly bitter irony that if the peace in Europe has been kept since 1945, it is because of NATO and the European Union, two institutions that Donald Trump has continually attacked. And so that sits a little uneasily with today's celebrations.
Let's talk about the complexity of the operation itself, because this wasn't a given that it would be successful.
Absolutely not. You only have to look at the fiasco, which was the Dieppe raid, which happened in August 1942, when the British tried to get a foothold on fortress, Hitler's European fortress, and failed miserably. It could have been cast back into the sea, and Rommel always said that that was how the Germans were going to defeat it, was by pushing the Allies back and stopping them on the beaches. So there's no gain said that D-Day had to succeed.
So why did it?
D-Day succeeded because the Allies crucially managed to have the element of surprise. They were incredibly successful with Operation Fortitude, this operation which allowed for deceptive operations, which made the Germans think that we might invade Norway or we might attack across the Pas-de-Calais. There had been separate operations going on in the Mediterranean. So the Germans were not expecting the attack in Normandy. And I think that is a large part of the success.
This was, of course, not the end. This was the beginning of a very deadly, very difficult and painful campaign for Allied forces and for the civilians who were living in that part of France.
Absolutely. 20,000 French civilians died as only part of the Allied bombing, which is something that Churchill initially thought was unconscionable. And he said it must be limited to 10,000. And D-Day is much more successful than the subsequent operation in Normandy itself, where the Allies really get bogged down in 8 weeks of intense fighting, which exceeds the death toll of some of the most famous battles of the First World War, like the Somme and Passchendaele.
And why was that a miscalculation? Why was it so deadly in the aftermath of D-Day?
I don't think that the Allies had either anticipated the extent to which the Germans would resist or the difficulties of the Normandy countryside, the bocage, where there are this small patchwork of interconnected fields with thick hedgerows in which Germans could launch surprise attacks. This really bogs them down. Also, the Germans had flooded so much of the area, so that caused problems for the paratroopers on the night of D-Day, but continued to cause problems for crossing Allied vehicles thereafter.
And then in the longer term, up until May of 1945, obviously when the Allied powers then, officially it was the end of the war in the European theater, what was that period like after D-Day? Because it was still a difficult battle.
An incredibly difficult battle, and there were setbacks such as the attack on the four bridges over the Rhine at Arnhem, and then obviously the main German counteroffensive known in America as the Battle of the Bulge. But we also have to remember this enormous battle that is going on the Eastern Front. If you look at statistics, total military deaths in World War II, the Russians accounted for 65% of them, the British 2%, the Americans 1%.
This is not... How many million did the Russians lose?
The Russians lost around 26 million dead during the...
It's very difficult to wrap your brain around that number.
It is.
Because in you know, modern warfare, it's become so technologically advanced. Obviously, civilians suffer a lot, but the military deaths are usually much smaller numbers.
No, and it is the Russians, however insidious the Soviet regime is and however awful what came after the Second World War with the Eastern Bloc, it was the Russians who paid the ultimate blood price for the defeat of the Wehrmacht.
Tim Bouverie, thanks very much for joining us. Appreciate it.